I think that my talk is a good continuation of the previous one. I will also speak about some aspects of the final theory. Perhaps I would prefer to call it final theory rather than the theory of everything, but it's the question of name is not important. That's better. I will dig into the deep structure of the universe, and I would say something about the ontology of the Planck scale. So it will be about the ontological interpretations of some physical speculations. That philosophy and the sciences interact with each other, and always did so, is a trivial fact which need not be to be argued for. And this interaction between philosophy and science assumed various forms. Identification, for instance, in the very beginning of philosophy, mutual support, like in Middle Ages, conflict in modern times, or even open enmity. Another form of this interaction is what I like to call philosophy in science. And it is also by no means a new phenomenon. Philosophical ideas were always present, if not in the results of the scientific theories, then at least in the close context of the most fundamental notions. And this phenomenon intensified with the advent of classical physics, relativistic and quantum revolutions made it even more pronounced, and the present search for the ultimate unification of physics, or theories of everything, enhance it, sometimes even beyond rational limits. New conceptions in theoretical physics, we heard about some of them in the previous lectures, need only a small philosophical underpinning to appear as radical ontological proposals. And in this talk, I intend to illustrate this statement with a few examples taken from the current research trying to penetrate into the physics of the Planck scale. If there is an ultimate theory or final theory, we believe it should be looked for at the fundamental level of the physical world, which is called the Planck level or Planck scale. And this is an outline of what I will be speaking about. The first traditional ontologies are not enough. That's perhaps the main thesis of my paper, perhaps the only thesis in my paper. I shall argue that the traditional ontologies commonly accepted by various philosophical schools are not enough. And then I will dig a little bit deeper into the problem of the background, space-time, and the problem of identity, the fact of changing ontology, and then the philosophy of change and causality, and some concluding remarks. So let's go to the first item. The traditional ontologies are not enough. And of course, it's an enormous simplification, but I will focus on three sort of ontologies. I call them rather symbolically Aristotelian ontology, Whiteidian ontology, and Kantian ontology. Of course, Kant was more epistemology than ontology, but it has certainly some ontological flavor. Very roughly, I underline, it is very rough characterization of what I call Aristotelian approach to ontology. In this approach, the primary entities are substances or natural bodies. I am not going into details. I am not concerned with what Aristotle himself said in reality, but what some people ascribed to him or claimed in a similar manner. These substances or natural bodies have certain properties that allow us to classify them into some categories. And the bodies sharing the same category belong to the same the same property belong to the same category. Between the bodies, various relations take place, which introduce an order into the collection of bodies. And in this ontological perspective, space and time are regarded as abstractions from the system of bodies. A Whitehedian approach is different. Reality is viewed as a process, a flux of events, not necessarily linearly ordered. It depends on concrete philosophical view. Events are regarded rather as a secondary with respect to process itself, and time does not only measures the process, but also belongs to its very nature. We can think here about, for instance, Bergson philosophy. And in both these ontological approaches, Whitehedian and Aristotelian, space and time are represented in the form of a continuum consisting of point-like entities, points or time instants. Kantian approach, the primary element is a cognizing subject. I am not using here the wording used by Kant himself. Space and time and other philosophical categories belong to the noetic equipment of the subject. They are forms a priori. And the world itself, things in themselves, is not accessible to the organizing, cognizing subject. We could say in a more popular way that subject projects onto the world the inner structure of its own epistemological equipment. This view, I mean the Kantian view, in various forms and various degrees of vulgarization is very common today. To many thinkers and other people, it seems consonant with the prevailing fashion today to emphasize the role of human being in all aspects of life. It goes without saying that all these ontological approaches have been powerfully shaped by our macroscopic experience. But as contemporary physics teaches us, the macroscopic level is far from being the fundamental level. So to construct the most adequate ontology of the world, we should go to a microscopic or to the submicroscopic experience. But because ontology, we believe, should be based on some experience. Of course, literally, it is impossible because the fundamental level, Planck's level, is not open for our senses. But we have at our disposal an intellectual experience informed by the scientific research into the most fundamental level of the world. And perhaps we should construct some ontological ideas on form some ontological concept basing on this intellectual experience, which is informed, which is not just from nothingness, it is informed by the scientific research into the most fundamental level of the world. And basing on that experience, I will face in this paper an ontological challenge coming from our insights into what could happen at the Planck scale. Could happen because actually we have no the responsible physical theory which would reconstruct physics on the Planck scale, but we have various competing theories which try to break down this enigma. And now the first ontological problem is the problem of which is called by physicists themselves the background problem, and the more philosophical problem, the problem of identity, which is strongly related to the background problem. The problem consists in the following. All macroscopical physical theories develop on the space-time arena. And various classical theories presuppose different geometric structures for space-time. There is a very almost one-to-one relationship between physical theory and what they presuppose about the geometric structure of space-time. Very different is the space-time of Aristotelian physics, and another is Newtonian physics and general relativity and so on. There are very interesting studies concerning this relationship between physical theory and the geometric background presupposed by them. And this geometric background is important because it provides a mean for identification of physical objects and measuring or at least parametrizing physical processes. For instance, in all classical theories, we assume some coordinates which serve to identify some physical objects, more or less. And there is a common belief among theoreticians, theoreticians which are looking for this theory of the fundamental level, and this belief is based on some partial results obtained so far, theoretical results, of course. There is a belief that from the fundamental point of view, the concept of space and time should be derived concept rather than given a priori. So the idea is that at the fundamental level there is no space-time, there is no geometric background. This background should emerge when we go to the lower levels of energy. For instance, one of the main objections against the superstring theory is that the superstring live in a space vapor, space-time background, I suppose, well, more or less like in theory of relativity. Of course, there are some attempts among superstring theoreticians to get rid of this background. On the other hand, proponents of another approach to quantum gravity, so-called loop quantum gravity, they claim that their theory is superior because it is free from, they call it background independent, free of presupposing the space-time a priori. They consider that as a great adventure, so yeah. And perhaps the most radical in this respect is approach to quantum gravity or superunification theories based on the so-called non-commutative geometry and quantum loop groups. Quantum groups, it is a, well, something which could be qualified as belonging to non-commutative geometry. But in fact, there are some two approaches. One is more from geometry, another from groups. In these two theories, quantum groups and non-commutative geometry, is very radical in this respect because in general, in this non-commutative geometry, there are no local concepts. The concept of points, of sharp localization disappears. I will come back to that in a moment. And now a very important warning that models based on non-commutative geometry are only tentative models of the fundamental level, because we have only tentative models. So they are no perhaps better, no worse than other approaches to Planck scale. But in the following, I treat these models based on non-commutative geometry in a hypothetical manner. So I assume that they are correct, and I want to show some conceptual, ontological consequences in the case some of the models based on that theory turn out to be correct. So if I will speak about ontological consequences, so they could be understood in that way. I don't claim that this ontology, which I will present, is the ontology of our real world. It is the ontology of the world which is described by this theory. So, and only if in the future we would discover that some experimental tests corroborate those theories, then we could ascribe them to to the real world. But such an intellectual exercise, I think, is very important because it shows us that our time-honored categories, ontological categories, should perhaps could be, would have to be rejected. So non-commutative geometry gets rid of localities and gets rid of this background, space-time background. This ideology finds a support in old philosophical idea, the so-called relational ontology. According to this doctrine, there are no points or point-like events that would be ontologically primary, but primary are rather a net relations, a network of relations, and points are but the places in this network of relations, the places in which, so to speak, this network is especially dense. So points and objects are secondary, relations are primary. But if you want to implement that doctrine into a physical theory or mathematical theory, the great difficulties emerge. From the logical point of view, it's extremely difficult to get rid of objects and replace them with relations. And I will illustrate that with a nice example of mathematics. There is a so-called mathematical theory of categories. Categories are very important in mathematics because they are candidates to form a new foundation for mathematics and replace, in this respect, the theory of sets. Sets are categories. The theory of sets is a category, but it's not one of the many categories. What is category? Category consists of class of objects. They are denoted by A, B, C, and so forth. And the class of morphisms. Morphisms can be thought of as functions from one object to another. But the point is that morphisms need not to be functions. Functions from one object to another are morphisms, but morphisms are much more general. This is why mathematicians call them simply arrows, arrow from A to B. So we have a class of objects and a class of arrows. And arrows can be composed in a natural way. One arrow follows another one under certain conditions. And also some conditions which have to be satisfied belong to the definition of the category. I listed these conditions, but they are not important so far. And if we want to get rid of objects and build everything on morphisms, then we should create what would be called objectless category. And something like that has been formulated. Objectless category. Category without objects. So how is it defined? The primary concept is that of morphism. There are no objects in the axioms of this theory. And the axioms concerning morphisms guarantee the composition of morphisms together with associativity and other, and the important point, existence of identity morphisms. They are absolutely necessary in order to have a category. So identity is an arrow which points from an object A to the same object A. It's identity. And it turns out that such axiomatization of category theories without the concept of object can be formulated, but it turns out that objects are implicitly defined by axioms, so they can be deduced. You cannot get rid of them. In a very simple manner, it is enough simply to establishing a one-to-one correspondence by ejection between identity morphisms and objects, and they are there. So the point is it possible to construct a mathematical theory without the concept of identity? And we do not know the answer to that question. Nobody was able to do that. To overcome this difficulty, to get it, you know, the idea is to get it off the background. And it is not that easy. And to overcome these difficulties, physicists invent various audacious, very strange doctrines. Perhaps the most audacious, doctrine was proposed by John Archibald Wheeler, who speculated that, this is his saying, pregeometry, which is not a background, something precedent geometry, pregeometry is a calculus of proposition. So he assumed that logic is in the beginning, and everything should be deduced, the entire physics, from the calculus of propositions, from elementary logic. It was in the 60s and 70s quite popular among some class of physicists. Unfortunately, this doctrine turned out to be not audacious enough. Namely, the progress of physics shows that the type of logic is strictly related to the class of mathematical structures one employs in one's research. Of course, yes, Boolean algebra, that is to say standard calculus of propositions, is presupposed by classical physical theory, that's true. But there are many other non-Boolean algebras which we know today, and some mathematical theories presuppose different theories. For instance, the famous Topos theory presupposes Heyting algebra, which is different from Boolean algebra. So it's different logic. It's paraconsistent logic, in fact. And so and there are very small chances that the fundamental level would presuppose classical logic. So it turns out quite obviously that it seems that it is the type of logic that is enforced by physical theorists rather than physics deduced from logic. So is it impossible to eliminate objects from ontology and make a relational ontology? So is it possible to eliminate identity morphism from mathematics? We do not have no answer about that. But we can put aside this problem as one of unsolved problems, important ones, and go to some other possibilities which are open for our inquiry. So my next point is the changing ontology. The usual geometry, so-called commutative geometry, the commutation law is very simple. 2 times 4 is the same as 4 times 2. But if it does not work in some mathematical object, it's not commutative. So the matrices are multiplied in a non-commutative way, for instance. So the usual geometry, our school geometry, or a Euclidean geometry, the geometry which is used in general relativity, is commutative geometry, and it can be done either in the terms of coordinates, which is the more standard way, or in terms of functions defined on a given space. The functions, for instance, all smooth functions defined on a given space, form what is called in mathematics algebra. So we can do geometry in terms of algebra instead of coordinates. Such a language, algebraic language, sometimes is more difficult, but it is more open for generalization, and this is why it's useful. And what is important that in the concept of point, if we consider all functions on a given space, for instance, this is a space, and you can imagine a lot of functions defined on this. What it would represent this point? All functions which vanish at that point, which are zero at that point, would could be identified with this point. And this mathematical structure, all functions vanishing at a given point, is an example of what mathematicians call maximal ideal of this algebra. So maximal ideas in the algebraic language are responsible for the existence of points. And now on some ontological consequences of that. There are some apparently so obvious structures, like, for instance, the concept of individual objects. And this is encoded, from the mathematical point of view, in the existence of maximal ideals in a given algebra. So our macroscopic world is described by some algebra, and the fact that there are some individual objects is encoded in the fact that it admits maximal ideas. So you see some connection between the structure of physical theory and some ontological consequences. The existence of individuum is certainly an ontological thing. And now in non-commutative geometry in general, there are some exceptions, but I put them aside. In non-commutative geometry, there are no maximal ideas. The existence of maximal ideas is a sort of self-contradictory thing in non-commutative geometry. So such in this context, the concept of point loses its meaning. Consequently, non-commutative spaces are, in principle, non-local. You could say global, but perhaps it's safer to say non-global. But of course, non-commutative geometry is a sort of geometry, or some people say pre-geometry, to use Wheeler's language. Even some physical theories or models are based on that mathematical structure, so we need some replacement of points, or some, say, generalization of a point. And there are some candidates, at least few of them. Perhaps the most common is the concept of states. This is a mathematical concept. If you have an algebra, so a certain function along this algebra is called state, but it corresponds to what physicists call the state, and what is in common language called the state. For instance, and state is a global thing, it's not a local thing. For instance, now my audience in this is, let's suppose, in the state of interest, so it concerns everybody, at least statistically, and perhaps in a moment it will be in the state of dullness and sleepiness, and then change from one state to another state. So it's a global thing. Concept of state is important in this approach. So this I already explained that. Technically, state is a linear function on an algebra which is positive and normal to unity. Doesn't matter what does it mean in detail now. And what is interesting that some non-localities are already met in quantum mechanics, which is empirically very well verified. For instance, in the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen experiment, two electrons know about each other in spite of the fact that they are so distant from each other that even the light signal cannot cover that distance. And we could say, from the mathematical point of view, there is nothing mysterious. This is called entanglement phenomenon in quantum mechanics. And this is a constant astonishment of people how there is such a communication between two electrons distant far away from different sides of galaxies, and they know about each other. From the mathematical point of view, there is no problem at all, because these two electrons are modeled or described by the same vector, which is an element of the corresponding Hilbert space, and this vector is simply not local, so distance is not important. It is important only when we translate that concept into our macroscopic ideas. But mathematics, everything is all right. And So we could say that the entangled phenomena which are met in quantum mechanics are just some remnants of this non-locality from the most basic level. So conclusion of this part of my talk, the ontology of the macroscopic, well, this is a mistake, misprint here, not microscopic, but macroscopic, our present world in which we live. The ontology of our macroscopic world is our reference ontology, because it's related to our senses and we refer to it everywhere. However, it is not a basic or primary ontology, but an ontology derived from an ontology of fundamental or more fundamental level than ours. The macroscopic world is but an effect of some averaging processes constituting deeper levels of reality. Of course, if you have a physical models based on non-commutative geometry, so we suppose that this non-commutative regime holds at the Planck level, and then there is a procedure how to get from this non-commutative geometry our commutative world. And the mechanism is that you are doing some averaging. And then we even say that averaging is non-commutative. So our ontology of our world is just effect of averaging or some other limiting processes. This means that the ontology changes with the scale of considered phenomena. And I must say that it was Dominic Lambert who turned my attention to the fact that ontology is adapted to a given scale of considered in our research. And now the problem of causality and change. We remember that one of the most fundamental problems of ontology was the problem of change, and Western ontology took off when Aristotle defended the possibility of change against Parmenides or Zeno paradoxes. And now we have a question, and a similar question about the possibility of change. How change is possible in a non-local environment? Change is from one point to another, the motion. And there are no points, so how change is possible? Of course, the concept of change should also be generalized. There is no change in the standard way, but in a generalized way. And non-commutative geometry provides such a generalization. Motion from point to point is excluded, but there are some mathematical tools which can allow us to define change globally. And it is not only kinematics change from without any forces, but also dynamical equations can be provided by non-commutative geometry. And of course, details of this dynamics depend on a particular model, but usually dynamics is given by the operator algebra. I said that non-commutative geometry is given by the algebra of functions or some other algebras, and if we have an operator algebra denoted here by M, and usually it is a von Neumann algebra, it's not important now what does it mean, and also it's algebra, this operator algebra must be given, and a state must be given, phi, which is, as we know already, it's a global concept. And in terms of these two things, state and algebra, dynamics can be defined. And here we have a dynamical object, it's sometimes called, it's a pair from Neumann algebra and a state on this algebra. Because there may be many states on a given algebra, so dynamical regime changes together with the state. For instance, here is an equation, the so-called Tomita Takasaki equation, which prescribes a certain dynamics, but this R indexed by A, there are some operators, H is Hamiltonian, so it is related to energy, and T, it is not time, but it is a certain parameter, which is a one parameter group, which serves as a time, but it is not a time because it's at this level there is no time in the sense of succession of events. This is only just a picture showing that some dynamical equations can be written, but of course interpretation of them is difficult because our imagination works within time and space. And the problem of dynamics is strictly connected with the problem of causality. A common view attributed historically to Hume is that physics does not grasp the causal nexus, but only sequence of events, which I think it is simply false idea, because physics provides us dynamical equations, and dynamical equations prescribe not only sequence of events, but also dynamical dependence from one state or another. So it's true that our senses do not grasp causality, but our equations so it is quite natural to identify these dynamical connections with causality. And now conclusion of that part. In macroscopic physics, causality, understood in this way, has a local character. The cause is here and the effect is there. In the non-commutative setting, we are confronted with a generalized causality that is deprived of this local character. Taking into account the fact that the problem of causality has far-reaching consequences for almost all branches of philosophy, we can see that the new understanding of causality can denote a big revolution in our philosophical perspective. And now we add also two other concepts to that set of elements of new ontology, time and probability. Of course, in non-commutative geometry, when it is applied to physics, time cannot appear in the usual form as a sequence of point-like instances. Another important characteristic of time is its error of time. And as we know, in the macroscopical physical theories, the error of time is usually connected with entropy, with growth of entropy. And entropy is essentially a statistical concept, a probabilistic concept. So time and probability in macroscopic physics are very strictly interrelated. And now the question, how probability can be defined in the environment in which there are no individuals or point-like events? Because probability presupposes a statistical mass, a set of units, and in non-commutative geometry there are no units. The point is, that there is a new mathematical branch which is called non-commutative theory of probability. It's a very difficult and very already elaborated topic. There are already big monographs about non-commutative probability. And just only one very short look at that. Technically, the probabilistic object in non-commutative geometry is a pair, M and phi, where M is again a non-commutative algebra, usually von Neumann algebra, and phi is a state on M. And this is already, I think, familiar to us. If we remember that M and phi is a dynamical object, and here we have the same mathematical structure, which is a probabilistic object. Phi is here what corresponds to probability measure. The difference between commutative and non-commutative probability is that in ordinary probability theory, in practice, there is only one measure, probabilistic measure, Lebesgue measure. And here are as many measures, as many states on the given algebra. So it's much, much richer. So this means the fact that dynamic object is the same as probabilistic object. This means that every non-cumulative dynamics is probabilistic in a generalized sense. And every probability has a dynamical aspect. So it's a nice unification of two separate objects, separate concepts. And conclusions of that part. Three important ontological properties of our macro world are unified in non-commutative structures: time, dynamics, probability, and we perhaps add here also causality. These three properties, which are in our macroscopic world, are different. In this perspective, these different concepts are limiting cases derived from the same unified ontology of the non-commutative regime. So non-commutative geometry is very beautiful because it gives us a natural unification of concepts. And this is not a dream like multiverse ideology, because it is a serious mathematical example, even if our world is not built in that way. So the corresponding mathematical theorems will be true. What does it mean, probability, if there are no localization concepts? How to interpret that? And my suggestion is that the only possibility that comes to mind is a generalized propension interpretation. Probability is a tendency, global tendency to something. Of course, it's a echo of Popper, propensity interpretation of probabilities. And we can say metaphorically that ontology of our macroscopic world is but the shadow of the ontology of the Planck scale. And now concluding remarks. In view of this presentation, many traditional issues, philosophical issues, should be reconsidered. I'm going now beyond physics and to big ontological and metaphysical questions. And now some examples. The problem of God as the first cause of the universe. What sort of causality applies to this relation between God and the world? If the causality at the background level is different from what we are used to call causality, how to extrapolate that to theology? So it's a great warning, and perhaps apophatic theology is here. Apophatic, that means negative theology, that we can only say that our concepts do not refer to God. The problem of the temporal beginning of the universe. What does it mean, the beginning, if there is no time and no on the fundamental level? So, of course, this problem was already somehow felt in traditional philosophy. You remember the doctrine of St. Thomas about the universe, which has no beginning, but nevertheless it is created by God. The act of creation is global, not related to a single initiation moment. So this is very well corresponding with what I am presenting here. Another big question, the problem of the human being, the problem of individuality is important for the human being, and now we shed a new light of the origin of individuality. So it is, I think, also interesting in this respect. And then the problem of determinism and chance. Determinism is one state determines another, it's local. How determinism looks in the non-local perspective. So I think it should be reduced to the analysis of concrete set of equations, non-commutative equations, and then the role of chance in that, which is also a non-local thing. How it does look from the global perspective. So by asking all these questions, and perhaps many other questions that should be asked, we can hardly argue against the existence of philosophy in science. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So then now a few minutes for questions, comments.
And then coffee, so questions should be short to accelerate coffee.
I would just say a few words, maybe for clarification, because the word object used by you is equivocal.
Certainly.
And you should probably distinguish between semantical object, which is probably a Kantian category. We cannot think of anything but in the category of being an object of our thought, of our language. Mm-hmm. What I understand by your meaning of object is a concrete object, local object.
Mm-hmm.
So there is a difference.
Yes.
This is an object of ontology of Kant. It's okay. Mm-hmm. But in Aristotle, forms are objects or not. They are not local. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Yes, but perhaps when I spoke, it was my own purpose. I was speaking about Aristotelian approach to ontology, not Aristotelian ontology, just to signal that I mean that in the loose way. So I meant not a substantial form, but what Aristotle calls natural
a
body.
Substance
already, yeah.
A thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Next question.
The most important concept used is the concept of state. I think that it's possible to precise this concept, because in the place of object comes state. We must identify the state. Yes? Because it's a very, very important moment to identify the state. What do you think about it? How can we identify the state? Only in the system of relations, or we can say the state have prime properties, or the state gets its properties from the relation to other states, but then I must identify the state at all. So what's the criterion of identification of state beyond?
Yeah. No, in this talk I never identified objects with the state. State is a technical term which can be very clearly defined. And it is a functional norm to unity and positive functional on a given algebra. This is the technical definition of the state. Whereas object is not a technical term, only in the theory of categories, object is, but it is by definition. Another technical term is a point or maximal ideal. And they are absent in non-continuous geometry, and they are in a sense replaced by state, not identified, but in a sense replaced. There are some other candidates to replace the points, for instance, irreducible representations of the given algebra, but it's too technical. In fact, state fulfill only some roles of local things. They are not identical.
Thank you very much. So, maybe one more. I have a question from the question in the end about aquatic theology and how do you think positive or negative theology is here better or perhaps. From the philosophical view, is a negative. We can say it means in general we can't say nothing about God. But from the Christian revelation, we can see something that God is good, God is love. How do you think does this ontology
say that in Polish and then I can this is not a limitation of English, it's a limitation of our language when we speak about God.
Te właśnie te argumenty, czy nie przeszkadzają właśnie w naszym pozytywnym języku o
Yeah, so I will answer, and in my answer the question will be there. Yeah. So the apophatic theology, negative theology, does not assert that we say nothing about God. We can say a lot of things. There's many, many things can be predicted about God. But we must be aware that if we say something about God, it is rather a negation of what God is than the positive statement. So there is some information, but we should always extrapolate that to infinity. But something we say something. So of course the positive theology, Western theology, because apophatic is more characteristic for the Oriental theology, Eastern theology. In our Western theology, there is a counterpart of that doctrine, the analogy theory. What we can say about God is always in an analogical sense. This is more or less the same.
So, thank you very much. You can finish our first session and we have now coffee break. Thank you very much.
So,